Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. First of all, I give all praise and glory to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, most beneficent. I supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His mercy, peace and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sabhi wa sallam. I seek forgiveness from the Almighty for any inherent mistakes which come from me. Know that he from whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none can misguide. And him whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads astray, none can guide. I would like to remind you that you should have taqwa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and none should die except in the state of al-Islam. Amma ba'd. I want to share with you in a few minutes the reasons why I accepted Islam. Inshallah, despite overwhelming social and familial obstacles, I was a Hindu. I'm at present a consultant in cardiology. I arise from an orthodox, affluent middle class family. From my childhood, alhamdulillah, I was a very avid reader and very much interested in the natural world, in forest, in animals, in the solar system, in the mysteries of the universe. I was born in the United Kingdom in 1966. Both of my parents were doctors and they were Hindus. In the atmosphere in England, we were not very religious. I never used to pray to God. I had no concept of that there is a God who has to be worshipped. However, my avid reading of encyclopedias, my interest in the programs by Zach Cousteau and Richard Attenborough, the variety of life. For example, if you just seeing the vivid color, the sophistication, the complexity of life on the land as well as in the sea, and the wonders of the universe, led me to think at a very age, has this all come by itself, or is there a reason? And is that the reason why people pray to God? In England, most of the people go to church on Sundays, and every Sunday they, and so I used, and, but I never used to pray every day, and so I used to ask my mother, why do people pray? So my mother used to tell me, yes, there is a God and you have to pray to him every night. But that was all the sort of conversation I had. That was the only knowledge and the only contact I had with religion during my stay in England. When I returned to India, it was a totally different experience from England straight to Andhra Pradesh, to the town of Nellore. Everything was different, the temperature, the climate, the people, the culture, the customs. And slowly I started to be introduced to the religious practices of my family. My mother used to take me to temples and we used to pray to give obedience to various idols. And then she used to come back and she taught me several slokas which I'm supposed to recite when I go to bed. Then I used to ask my mother, what is God? So my mother said, God is he who has created all this. He has created you. And after you die, you must do good works. You must do good deeds in order to go to heaven. And if you don't please God, you'll go to hell. Then I said, if God is so powerful, if God has created everything, why are you going to a place and worshipping something which is limited, which obviously is made of stone? Is that God who cannot talk, who cannot eat? My mother was not able to answer the questions clearly. So she brought several priests and they told me that, no, it is not that the stone is a God. We don't believe that. But we believe that in order to approach God, you approach God through a symbol, just like a baby. A baby cannot walk immediately, so it has to clutch on something. So once, after some time, you clutch on the symbol. After some time, there is no need for the symbol. And then it goes away. Then they give the example of Vivekananda. The Vivekananda went to a Nizam. And then he said that he wants some donation. So the Nizam said, I am a Muslim. I cannot give you any money. Then he said, look, there is a photo on the wall. Shall I spit on it? He said, no, I will not spit on it. Why can't you? You said you don't believe in idol worship, you don't believe in photos, then why don't you spit on it? No, it's not that I'm giving any worship to it. It's just that as a token of respect to my father. I said, in the same way we worship idols. It is not that idol is worshipped. It is just a token. And subsequently, when you lose necessity for this token, the token disappears. So I was not, that sort of satisfied me at that point of time. And then I thought, in order to get a more complete picture, you have to read. Because alhamdulillah, my interest is in reading. I have to read, I have to know by myself. I don't like to be told by somebody to do this. I want to see whether it is true. That's when I started my research into what is God, what is the concept of God, what is the theology, and is it acceptable or not. So I started reading the basic books of a Hindu, that is the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. What I found that even though there were several points which were interesting and did make a lot of sense, it was covered by so many facts which defy imagination, which was exaggeration blown out of proportion. So then I thought to myself, how can this be? Look, what is the historical authenticity of these stories? Look, they say that the Mahabharata occurred in the Treta Yuga, it occurred before the Ramayana. But if you look in the history of India, the kingship is very recent. In fact, you can date the kingship just after 1 BC, just to the Maurya dynasty. Prior to that, there were no kings. Whereas here, you see that the idea of kingship is before the Mahabharata. So that is a historical contradiction. Like that, there are numerous. I don't have time to go into each and every contradiction and into each and every detail which unsettled me. But in short, what I found is there is no historical authenticity for the events which were narrated in the Puranas. Then I thought, what should I do? Okay, I'm not having enough historical evidence. But what about the philosophy? So what is the roots? What is the source of Hindu knowledge? There are three. The root source is the Vedas. Two is the ten main Upanishads. And third is the Bhagavad Gita. Then I selected the Bhagavad Gita. I have read all of the four main commentaries, that is by Shankara, by Aurobindo, by Radhakrishnan, and the fourth I don't remember. And even though there's a lot of high philosophical speculation, again, a lot of contradictions. And if you see in the Bhagavad Gita, one spot he says that God is everywhere. God is the all-seer. God is the all-hearer, but none. All God hears everything, but none can hear Him. God knows everything, but none can know Him. And God can see everything, but none can see Him. But then look at the reality. What are the Hindus doing? They go to a temple and they see an idol of Krishna and they see Him. And that idol cannot see Him back. They give food to Him, but He doesn't give anything back in return. So isn't there a contradiction? So does that mean that means that the entire practice of the present day Hindu community is a hypocrisy? That's when I started to know that I cannot get the answers from any of the Hindu community, because most of them are not aware of what is in their books, and what is there, they do not care. So then I started going to the root source, to the Vedas. The problem with the Vedas is number one, just look at the way in which this is supposed to be the Bible or the most holy book of the Hindus. It is supposed to be the direct revelation from God. But you examine the way in which the Vedas were revealed. According to the source, the Veda Vyasa, who is supposed to be the writer of the Mahabharata and the compiler of the Vedas, he narrated the inspired truth to the elephant god Ganesha, who, because he didn't have a pen, broke his tusk and used the tusk to write down the Vedas. Now I thought to myself, is this literally possible? Is it possible? Do you think this literally happened? No. In such a fundamental issue of faith, if there is so much exaggeration, what can I believe and what can I not believe? That means that you can, all of the pillars upon which you give your devotion are totally exaggeration. And why should I pray to something which does not answer me back? Why should I pray to something which has absolutely no shred of historical authenticity, when you don't have the original scripture, when even the person who wrote it is doubtful? There are many doubts whether a person called Vedavyasa existed. They say that it's a series of ballads. The question of whether the Mahabharata occurred at all. And look at the characters in Mahabharata. Look at Krishna, whom everyone treats as God. Just examine the way in which Krishna was born. the way in which Krishna was spirited away, the way in which he grew up, the way in which he fled from King Jarasandha because he due to fear, the way in which the whole story narrates. Is this the picture of Almighty God? Is this the man whom you worship? And look how he died. He died like any normal human being. He was born like a human being. He lived like a human being. He had weaknesses like a human being. And he died like a human being. Yet, a majority of educated people worship him. Isn't that a contradiction? All these questions were totally unanswerable. The return you get from your family is, this is what my father did, my forefathers have done, this is what our society does, so you should do it. I said, that's ridiculous. You can't follow something because somebody tells you so. You follow something because it is the truth, and this is not the truth. None of these, 90% of these incidents which have occurred in your scriptures have not taken place. So how can you take it as verbatim? And how can you listen to that and worship? And worship that. So it resulted in a lot of confusion. So I thought to myself, what is it do you believe? Then I took a summary of the Upanishads and the Vedas. On one statement really struck me. Ekam eva dvitiyam. That is, there's God is one without a second. That was one statement which I thought it is true. But subsequently, if you go to the next essence, sarvam halvidam brahmam, or aham brahmasmi. Again, it's a total contradiction, because when you say sarvam halvidam brahmam, you mean that everything in this world is a manifestation of God. And I need not elaborate what that means. You can imagine it for yourself. So I thought those two are contradictory. It can't be true. You can't have, say, ekam eva dvitiyam, and at the same time say sarvam halvidam brahmam. It's contradictory. And how can God say contradictory statements? God cannot be contradictory. Then take the third, aham brahmasmi. That's utter ridiculous, because that means that I am God. That's ridiculous, audhu billah. Even to mention that, how can you with all your weaknesses, your fallibilities, your birth, how can you? To what depravity have you reached? Isn't this a proof that all this theory is a product of human perspiration and not divine inspiration? That was it. I had finished my MBBS and I had decided almost that this sort of philosophy is wrong. There's polytheism, idol worship, there's a question of omnipotence, on which Hinduism is based on omnipotence. That is, the concept that there is one God, and from this God emanates the entire universe. So, and they give the example of air. If you have a pot, and air enters the pot, the air in the pot and air in the space are the same air. If you remove the pot, it is one. It's only when you put the pot that you see the limitation. That is when it struck me. See, how can you try to explain, analyze, interpret that which created you? If I am a doctor, can I understand if I'm given a topic in Boolean physics, or if I'm given even a topic in obstetrics and gynecology, I don't know anything. I can't comment. When I can't even comment on something in this material universe, which is within the power of my intellect, how can I comment, discuss, analyze, explore that which is beyond my intellect? This was the point which gave me conviction that this is not the right path. Hinduism is based on falsehood. So then I thought, what are my next alternatives? I entered into a phase of atheism and communism for a couple of years. But subsequently, I found that even though the principles of communism, from each according to his ability, to each according to his need, is interesting, it is impossible to apply unless the human being himself is good. And I need not go into the details to say that communism is a failure. Because it is not a practical philosophy. It has no stuff to back it. Because it depends upon the innate goodness of the human being, which does not exist. Then I started turned my intention to other religions. I studied for a while Buddhism, but because they were totally uncertain, even though uncertain as to whether God exists or whether God doesn't exist, I thought that they don't have the truth. So then I turned towards Christianity and Judaism. I started reading the Bible. I read Thompson's Bible Concordance. I tried to read the Septuagint. I wanted to learn Hebrew. I was very much fascinated by the simplicity of the teachings of Isa alayhi salam. Man lived not by bread alone, from every word that emanated from the mouth of the Lord, etc. And then I thought, this is something, and Sabbath is not, man is not for Sabbath, but Sabbath for the man, etc. So I thought these parables were striking. It comes to the heart. And your left hand should not, doesn't know what your right hand giveth. Things like that. So then I thought, maybe there is truth in this. This man speaks very simply. Then I started exploring Christianity. I read the Bible. I started reading the concordance. Then I attended Bible classes. But after the seventh day, the evangelist talked to me, said, "See, you should stop. You should understand that we are not idol worshippers. You should stop worshiping other gods. But you should accept that this man is Isa alayhi salam. That through him only you get salvation." Then I said, "What do you mean?" Then I said, "It means that you have to accept that he died on the cross for you and his blood saves you." Then I said, "Whoa, wait a minute. For some thousands of years ago, Christ died on the cross and he knew that I am there in the 20th century. And then, so that is why he shed his blood. I have to accept that and accept his blood and I am saved." He said, yes. I said, "That's it?" When he said that, he said, "Yeah, if you say in your heart that the blood of Christ will save you, that's it." And I said, "What you say, it sounds very much like what our Hindu priests say. Moreover, you go to the church, look what all this." No, we don't believe in all these idols in church. That is another sect." "Oh," then how many sects are there in Christianity?" "We are no, there are more than 60 or 70 sects, but we are separate. We build a wall around ourselves. We only believe in Jesus." I said, "See, this Jesus character sounds like Krishna. Obviously, whatever you say, Jesus is not God. I have rejected Hinduism not to select another Krishna. I want to worship the one and only God, and Jesus is not God." Then he says, the "Jesus is the Son of God." I said, if I accept Jesus as Son of God, I can accept Krishna's incarnation of God. There is no difference. Is what you and I came off the next day. We had a quarrel, and I came off. Then I thought, the only professing monotheistic faith in the world is Judaism. Then I started reading the Torah, the Hebrew Bible. I spent quite some time. I bought the Torah in English with its Hebrew commentary, and I went through it. Alhamdulillah, I didn't have to spend much time. By the time I finished Genesis, I knew the first chapter of Deuteronomy. Before I finished Deuteronomy, I knew there's something fishy. One is the question of chosen people. It didn't strike me as very logical. Why the Jews should be the chosen? On what is the basis that they say they are the only people who will go to heaven and hell? On what basis? And secondly, if you read Genesis, if you read especially this word in Genesis turned me away from Judaism. According to them, Yaqub alayhi salam, when he was returning to Bait Lahim, he went to sleep. And in his dream, he wrestled with a man, and that man lost. And that man was God, A'udhu Billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That itself said, if their God is someone whom their prophet can defeat, and what sort of God are they worshipping? Moreover, such a headweight people, chosen people, but look what happened with Musa alayhi salam. Did they follow his commandments? You look at the history of the Jews. Every prophet they came, they rejected. They rejected Isa alayhi salam, they rejected Yaqub alayhi salam. All the prophets they have rejected. And yet they say they are the chosen people. What is the basis? How come they be chosen? Then I decided definitely Judaism cannot be a monotheistic religion. They are hypocrites. And at that point of time, I was totally confused. I knew that there's God exists because there's this order, there's so much order in creation, it's impossible for it to have arisen by itself. It's just like we see in the human society. If you see anybody who, from outside, an alien coming, will know that it can't arisen by itself. It has to be created. In the same way where you can't accept a simple small computer to be created by itself, how can you accept this entire universe, this entire living system and non-living system to come by itself? So God does exist, and God is one, and there is no need to have any priests or any rituals. But how am I to worship Him? How am I to approach Him? How am I to pray? I was totally ignorant. At this point of time, I was in Perinthalmanna, in Maulana Hospital. One day, I was thinking of these questions actually with my friend's mother. She was very sick in the ICU. I was spending the whole night in the ICU when my friend, his name is Moiduti, he asked me, "Do you believe in God?" I told him, "Yes, I come from a Hindu family, I do believe in God." Then he asked me, "What is your belief?" He said, "I believe, look, I don't believe like the Hindus in polytheism, I don't believe in idol worship. I believe that there is only one God who is worthy of worship, and I believe that that no priests are necessary to approach him. It's a direct relationship. But I am not very sure, and I pray to him in my own way. Then he said, many things of what you said form the basis of Islam. What do you think of Islam? I said, in my opinion, I don't know much about Islam, but in my opinion, it's an offshoot of the Judaism and Christianity. It came later. The first religion was Judaism. So I don't think that the people are very violent and very narrow-minded, and they're very very backward. So I don't really have any impression of Islam. Then he said, okay, and he brought two of his friends. Then he started to explain to me the five pillars of Islam. What really struck me was the concept of Tawheed, the uniqueness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the point which really caught my attention in the beginning, because as my studies in other faiths, no other religion has not only specifies but practices this unique worship of one deity without associating other partners of him, which was the main reason why I turned away from Hinduism and started searching for new faiths. So that caught my attention immediately. But then I started asking about other issues like women's rights, terrorism, etc., etc. Then he asked me whether I judge a car by its driver or by the qualities of the car itself. I thought for a minute. Yes, a Mercedes S-Class is one of the best cars. But supposing it is drunk, it is driven by a drunken driver who does not know how to drive. What will happen? The car will have an accident. So who's to blame? Do you blame the car or do you blame the driver? So similarly, the people who are so-called Muslims today are not practicing Islam as it should be practiced. And that is why you're looking at their practice, you are thinking that is what Islam advocates. It's because of my ignorance, so I should know more about Islam. So then my friend gave me three books. He gave me one book was Road to Mecca by Muhammad Asad. He gave me the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by Muhammad Hussein Haikal. And he gave me the third book was a translation of the Quran by Abdullah Yusuf Ali. To start with, I was not very much attracted by the Road to Mecca, as I felt it was not very informative. It did not give the details about Islam, its Aqidah, the Tawheed, and the Sharia, the Fiqh, etc. It was a more of a general reading which did not very much attract me. However, the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by Muhammad Hussein Haikal was captivating because of its language. A very good English was used, and the story of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his seerah, how he got revelation, how he struggled, the emigration, his companions, that really moved me. That showed me what Islam was in a sense. It's totally different from the Islam you see today. Of course, I still had lots of questions. Moreover, issues in the Haikal's book was quite unsettling. But I left it at then because I had just started to learn Islam. So at that point of time, I told my friend that, see, I accept Islam. I want to become a Muslim. Then he asked me, Have you thought about it for 2 days and come back and tell me. So then I came back and thought, okay, what does Islam, what do you understand by being Islam? So one is, say, first is Tawheed, the principle of Tawheed. The second is that you have to follow not only the Quran, but you also have to follow it in the way in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has advocated. And the third point was that you cannot add, subtract, delete or innovate any new things in this religion. These three points I sort of knew. I was clear in Tawheed, but upon points B and C, I wasn't very sure. I didn't understand the relevance of the Sunnah or the Hadith at that point of time. I wasn't, the topic of innovation was quite new to me. But so then I thought, I was a bit unsettled by these two. What does this mean? What does the Sunnah and Bidah mean? But then I thought, so what should I do now? Should I what is it, this one chance I have, Allah Subhanahu knows whether I will have this chance again or not. Should I accept the truth of Tawheed, which I know to be true, which matches the essence of what I've been struggling to find over 20 years? Or should, for the sake of temporary values, and I really thought about these temporary values, what does this life mean, your society? You eat, you drink, you satisfy your family's needs, then you mingle with the people whom you know in society, and then you die, isn't it? Ultimately you will die. So is this the meaning of life? Why, that is what animals also do. You look at a hyena or a lion or any animals, they also eat, drink, they also look after their young ones, they also to a certain extent bring them up, and they also die. So what is the difference between that and us? We have consciousness, we have discrimination to decide what is right and what is wrong. So what is the essence, what is the basis of contention here? Basically it is Tawheed versus polytheism. So which is true? I know Tawheed is true. So whatever it is, I have to accept Tawheed, because I cannot accept the truth after 20 years. So then I went and told my friend, I'll accept Islam. Then he said, what about your family? I told him, Moiduti, come after 1 month, he said. I told him, Moiduti, will you give me a guarantee that I'll be alive after 1 month? He said, no. Then I said, I know I have problems. I know the circumstances I have. But inshallah, this is the truth, and this is my only chance, and I'll accept this now, and inshallah, if I have the power, I'll have the patience and perseverance to tackle the problem successfully in future. And that is when I said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah, and I accepted Islam. Immediately after I accepted Islam, my job was terminated and I was removed back to Trichur. And I will tell you from my experience that it's not that as soon as you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah, a golden throne is brought before you, and then you are lifted in the air, and everything will be solved. No, my friend, because the writings on water, la ilaha illallah, has to become firm conviction, engraved on stone. So yes, you will face trials, tribulations, difficulties, uncertainties. But if you are patient, if you are perseverant, if you are submissive to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you constantly strive to follow the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ultimately victory will be yours. For victory lies in patience. I will tell you from my personal experience. I was brought back to Trichur. I have no contacts. My iman was very tender. It had not yet deeply entrenched in my house. I have not read the Quran. I don't know anything about the Sunnah. I don't know anything about innovation. It was just that I said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. That was the only thing I knew of Islam. And on top of that, I had to face several stormy sessions with my family. My wife and family used to ask me, look, you're married 20 years now. You've got 2 children. Your mother is all alone. Who is going, how your wife has got no options now. How can you face the society? How can you face your family? And they knew that they could not ask me the reasons why I embraced, because they knew that in this particular area they were futile. So I used to have very stormy sessions on these particular points. Initially, because of my weak iman, because my iman was weak, I used to stay indoors. I used to do my salah within closed doors. I used to speak very softly. I used to keep away from my companions. I tried my best to conform to the wishes of my family and not to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. But alhamdulillah, praise be to Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, I did not lose faith. I knew that my knowledge was weak. So then I slowly started to read books, for like the Kitab of Tawheed by Shaykh Muhammad Wahab, the Foundation of the Sunnah by Shaykh Ahmad ibn Hanbal. I read the transliteration of the Holy Quran by Shaykh Muhammad Hilali and Muhammad Mohsin Khan. I read the Tafsir of Surah Maryam by Shaykh Yahya Ibrahim. I listened to many of the CDs of the Sakit Nayak. And slowly, the very process by which I rejected Hinduism, through the grace of Almighty Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the accumulation of knowledge firmed my Islam. I started to understand what is the Sunnah and why is the Sunnah important. Because if not for the Sunnah, Islam will be no different than Christianity or Judaism. All the other monotheistic faiths have deviated because of the lack of the Sunnah. Because people interpreted their scripture and corrupted their scripture. But because of the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sunnah has preserved the prophetic way of following the Quran. And who better to explain the Quran than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So this knowledge released me. And slowly by slowly, I started to change my obedience from my family, from trying to satisfy my family to trying to satisfy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. And I find that this is not in a day. Human being is like lightning. Everything he wants in 1 second. People, you think that you say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah like 1 second. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely test you, will test your faith, will test your heart, will test you with trials, will test you with calumnies, will test every fiber in your body to see whether you'll reject, whether you'll deviate, whether you'll innovate, whether you'll turn back, whether you'll turn your back. But if you are patient, if you are obedient, if you have taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you have faith and if you are perseverant, ultimately victory will be yours. I know that now, today, alhamdulillah, I pray openly, I recite the Quran loudly, I have all new companions. I am a totally changed person. I am not saying I have achieved perfection, but I am saying I am striving to perfection. And what is that perfection? The perfection is when you put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger in front of everybody, in front of all things. Once you have achieved that, you achieve perfection. And inshallah, I should be able to achieve, I am striving my best towards it. So, after 20 years of search of the truth of the Creator and His slaves, it has taken me to find Islam. I knew at the time I accepted Islam, I don't have any material benefit, no position, no power. In fact, in many ways, it was an apparent loss. But the question of loss of what? Loss of material at the gain of my soul. My soul has benefited because for once after 20 years, the questions, the stirrings in my heart have ceased. I know I am on the right path. And I know that if I am patient, if I am perseverant, if I always keep Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger above that of anybody else, if not today, tomorrow, or day after, I will surely win, inshallah. So I have. This has taken me 20 years to accept. So the more pressing issue is, why did I commit? The answer lies in the heart. My mind cannot think. My intellect cannot analyze. My lips cannot utter. My fingers fail to quiver to express the cry of my heart. For I realize that the mind, the akhal, cannot guide itself, but has to come from the inspired heart. And the inspiration only comes when you turn in submission to He who is only worthy of worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and only through the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfirullah wa tuba walayh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.